Hello everyone and welcome to our lecture on image filtering. Today we will talk about box filters and Gaussian filters in the beginning. Then we will look at some very basic and common example application scenarios for image filtering, image denoising and image sharpening. Then we will look at median filtering, which is a nonlinear filter. And we will end our discussion with some image morphology. So without losing any time, let's just jump into MATLAB and see what we mean by filtering with a simple 1D example. Let's first see what we mean by filtering in a simple 1D example. I will create a simple one-dimensional matrix that are initially all zeros. And let's set some of the values here to be 1. We can plot how this looks in our figure, and let's put the command hold on so that we can put more plots on the same figure all together. Let's define our first filtering kernel. This is what we call a kernel or a filter, and this will be just simple one. This is called a box kernel because when you plot it, it looks like a box. In order to filter the signal, let's create our filtered result. And what we will need to do is for each overlapping segment, we will define our filtered result as the weighted sum of our signal and the kernel. And we plot our filtered signal. It will look like this. So this is called cross correlation because what we are doing here is we are putting the kernel first here and then here and then here and checking how well these two signals match each other. Since this is all ones around here in the middle and our kernel is also all ones, it creates a very high response at the top here. We can see this phenomenon more clearly in this illustration from Wikipedia. But as you can see, our input has the maximum value 1, but because we have 3 ones that we multiply and add them up in the filtered result, the maximum here goes up to 3. That is not something we want in images because 1 in our double image representation is already fully white. And when we filter images, in most of the filtering operations that we do, we want the image to stay around the same values and just change in terms of its content. We will see image filtering in a bit. But in order to make sure that the maximum does not change or the range of values in the filtered result do not change, we need to normalize our kernel so that the elements in it sum up to 1. Then what we are doing is a weighted average when we are doing filtering. And we can do this by dividing our kernel by the sum of its elements. Redo the operation again. Then it will give you the maximum value of 1 because that was the maximum value of our input signal. Now the operation we are doing there is called cross correlation, that is defined like this. But when we are talking about image filtering, we will use a similar but different operation called convolution. You will see that only some signs are reversed. And effectively, this is the same as just flipping our kernel and doing the cross correlation. But we gain a lot from using convolution instead of cross-correlation definition mathematically. For example, convolution is commutative, so it doesn't matter which one comes first and which one comes second. It is associative, which means that if we want to filter an image with two different filters, we can actually convolve the filters beforehand and then do the image filtering afterwards, which saves a lot of computation time. While correlation is not associative, for example. Convolution distributes over addition, which means that if you want to filter two images and then add them up, these type of things can happen when you are doing image processing and computer vision. You can first add them up and then filter it once, for instance. Another important characteristic of convolution will appear next week in our signals and images lecture, because convolution in the spatial domain or the image domain is equal to multiplication in the frequency domain. But this will clear out next week after we talk about signals. But even from the word convolution, you might infer that this is a very important thing that we do to images. And convolutional neural networks, for example, are about learning kernels of the filters that we convolve with images over and over again at different steps, which we will talk about next week as well. The first filters we will talk about will be linear today, and that has some advantages. Linearity is defined like this, and it kind of means that these filters do a linear combination of the neighbors of a pixel when they are filtering the image. These filters are also shift invariant, which means that their behavior do not change from one image region to the other. There are also shift variant filters, like edge-aware filters that we use a lot in image processing and image denoising. And you will read about a very important edge-aware filter called bilateral filter in your reading assignment for today. Now, let's read our image to be filtered. Let's convert it to double. And let's look at it. This is my brother, who is constantly a subject for my photography experiments in my papers and in my work. And he will be our model today. So let's define our box kernel as we did with the one-dimensional signal, but this time as a two-dimensional kernel. So if it was a small kernel, it would look like this if it was a 5x5 kernel, for example. As simple as that. But we will use a larger kernel because we have a larger image to be filtered here. And of course, we should normalize the values in it. Notice that I am flattening this kernel when I am summing them up so that the sum gives me a single value, not an array of values. And let's convolve our image with the kernel and look at what we get. I will convert the image to gray first to show you this, because this convolution function only takes two-dimensional signals and not three. Okay, so when we take the weighted average of every pixel with 25 by 25 window around it, this is the image we get, a filtered blurred out image. This is called box filtering. And we can actually do this with a color image also easily with the MATLAB function that makes the convolution on images a bit more convenient to do. There it is. Let's define a special kernel definition called the Gaussian kernel. And we can use the special function definition in MATLAB to create this kernel called if special. This means that this filter will be 41 by 41 and the Gaussian in it will have the standard deviation of 8 in both dimensions. I am choosing odd numbers for the size of the kernel on purpose because the pixels are discrete, and if you want to center one kernel on top of the pixel perfectly, the size of it needs to be an odd number. And we can actually look at the shape of our kernel using the surf function that stands for surface, because it creates a surface visualization. This is our Gaussian kernel. Look at this nice smooth shape. Now let's talk about this Gaussian kernel for a bit. Gaussian distribution is a very fundamental type of probability distribution that we see in nature. This is actually called normal distribution in probability, and that's because we see it everywhere. Most of the things we see in nature are Gaussian distributed, and not even in nature. Your grades at the end of this semester will be a Gaussian distribution, and that's called the bell curve, or that's how we grade on a curve, because we assume that your grades will come as a Gaussian distribution. The Gaussian distribution is defined like this. I am calling it distribution, but it can be also used as a kernel. And it has a very simple relationship with a single parameter called sigma, that is the standard deviation of this one. It has some very nice characteristics. For example, you can convolve a Gaussian with another Gaussian and you will get yet another Gaussian. And again, when we talk about frequency domain next week, we will see that Gaussians are actually also Gaussians in the frequency domain after Fourier transform. And Gaussian filter will probably be the filter that you use the most. And when you are dealing with noisy data, it can be images or it can be something else in between that you find while doing computer vision, you can apply a Gaussian filter to it to get rid of any annoying noises and stuff, so that you can apply your algorithm peacefully. This is very useful. Let's filter our image with the Gaussian kernel and the box kernel and look at how different the results look. And let's crop the image as we look at it. First put our image, then our box filtered image and Gauss filtered image side by side. Now, as you can see, both images are blurred, but they have a bit different characteristics. You might notice that the Gaussian blurred image looks like a more naturally blurred image, while in the box kernel you have these type of weird edgy things that doesn't really look that nice. And the reason why this is happening will be much clearer after our signals and images lecture. And when you are creating a Gaussian kernel, you should be careful about the size of your kernel. So let's look at different kernels and see what I mean. Let's create a 21 by 21 kernel that has the 10 standard deviation of Gaussian. As you can see, the kernel ends before the Gaussian becomes zero in all directions. And this even gets worse if you create a larger variation Gaussian filter. See? So in order to properly Gaussian filter an image, you need to make sure that the filter size that you have is able to represent the whole shape, or at least most of it, that is acceptable for your application. So for 15, for example, the size 50 is around okay, but if we have a 75 sized filter, then it will be even more complete. But there is a catch here, because when you have a larger kernel, the computation takes much longer. When we are computing convolution, we have to do a lot of simple operations for each pixel. And the complexity is n to the power 2, n being the size of your kernel. For example, if we have an 11 by 11 kernel, we will have to do 121 multiplications followed by 120 additions to get the filtered pixel. This is only for a single pixel, and this has to be repeated for every single pixel. But if we have a 3 by 3 filter, for example, you will only have to do 9 multiplications and 8 additions to get the result per pixel. But some of these kernels can be defined as separable kernels, as 2 1D kernels instead of a one single large 2D kernel. And these type of filters are called separable filters. The idea here is you separate its effects on X and Y axis, and you first filter it in one direction, and you filter the already filtered image again in the second direction, and you will get the same result as using the two-dimensional kernel. If we have a kernel that is 11 pixel long, for example, we had to do 120 multiplication operations. Here, when we separate them, we can do 11 multiplication and 10 additions followed by the same thing. So around 20 multiplications and 20 additions, which is faster than using the 2D kernel. And this gets even better as your filters get larger and larger. So let's separate our Gaussian kernel. That was the Gauss kernel, this one here. We will pick the center row of it to make it a one-dimensional signal. We can plot it to see if we did a good job. Yep, this is a one-dimensional Gaussian. Now I can filter the image with this one-dimensional kernel this time. And it will give me a completely black result because I forgot to normalize my Gaussian kernel. So it doesn't sum up to 1, but something much less than 1. Let's see. As a result, you get a very dark image. So let's normalize it. And then look at our result. There you go. This has been only blurred in the X direction. We will look at it yet again, so let's create a variable for it. And for the Y direction, we need to filter it with a raw filter. So this filter we have here is composed of columns right now, but I can convert this to a set of rows by using the transpose function or the transpose operation in MATLAB, which is just this one. Then it will make it a row. And we can use this kernel to create our Y direction filtered image called filthy, not filthy. And we can do the full filtering by filtering the image two times with these two one-dimensional kernels, which would be this. So this is me filtering it in the X direction and then yet again in the one direction in a single line. Let's look at our Y filtered image. See, it is blurred in the y direction, and we can look at our XY filtered image, which should be the same as our Gaussian filtered image. See, this is called separable kernels or separable filters. We can also look at them together so that everything is clearer. Now let's create a different type of kernel. Let's call this kern, and let's first set it to all zeros. That will be a 41 by 41 size kernel, and I will just make a single element of it, one. We can look at our kernel simply like this. This will be where the center pixel is located, and the only element 1 in this image, in this kernel, is at the top corner. So as I do the filtering and show you the result, try to guess what will happen to the image in the end. I will crop the images so that we can see the effect more clearly. You can use this AND function to just signal the image, signal MATLAB that you want the rest of the rows or columns. And let's look at them side by side. You might realize that this image have been shifted. See, the edges are at different places, because when we are using this type of kernel, what convolution does is when you center it around an image, in the filtered result, the only thing you will get is 1 times the underlying neighbor pixel here in the result, which is a shift operation. And we can see this a bit more clearly with a simple alpha blending trick. So as we did in our previous lecture, I will multiply and add 2 different images using an alpha, but here I am just using a fixed 0.5 alpha for the whole image, so that I don't need an alpha map, but I just need a single alpha value for the whole image. And when we overlay these images, we can clearly see what type of a shift that filtering operation did to the image. One useful application, or one very useful application of filtering, is denoising. So let's see how filtering does denoising with a much smaller filter. If we look at this filter, it will be a much smaller approximation of a Gaussian function, because we only use 5 by 5 elements in this one. And let's create our filtered image. And let's look at a crop again. I've written down these coordinates beforehand so that I don't have to look all the time with the MATLAB tool. This is what we call noise, where due to the camera characteristics or the illumination conditions or for many other reasons, the camera cannot record the actual pixel values but only a noisy version of them. And when we do a light Gaussian filtering on top of it, yes, we do lose some of these edges because we are indeed blurring, but we also get rid of most of the noise that is happening in the background. Denoising is of course useful for just denoising photographs, but as we will see, especially in our next edge lecture, it will be a very useful tool to first do before we do some simple computer vision tasks to make our lives easier. And let's look at another application scenario called sharpening. So we have our filtered image that is just a smoother version of the original image, but we can also have a look at the difference between this image and our original image and see what that shows us. I am taking the absolute value here because ImShow cannot show us negative values. We can enhance it a bit so that the things are more visible to us. Okay, so what we are seeing here is the strong edges that appear in the image. And we get these edge information because the difference between the original image and the filtered image is just exactly these edges. And we can make use of this observation to make the edges a bit stronger in the final image, which is called sharpening, which looks like this. We add this extra edges again to the image. And then the edges will be stronger in the result. Let's look at it side by side with our original image. To see the difference more clearly. See? Until now, we talked about linear filtering, but let's look at a nonlinear filter. And for this, we will see the median filter on images. But first, let's remember what median means. And for this, I will create an array of integers using the randintegr function. This will take the maximum value of 1. It will have 1 column and 11 elements. When we compute the median of this sequence, it will give us whatever the value is in the middle when you sort these values. And you can also sort yourself and check if 47 is in the middle, for example. This is just a definition of what median is for a series of numbers. When we do median filtering, what the filter does is, if it is 7 by 7, for example, it sorts all the 49 values and then gives you the middle one. So this is not linear because you cannot add or multiply these up and get the same result as in the end. Let's median filter an image. The median filter function in MATLAB only allows single channel images, so I'll just create a grayscale version of the image first using the function RGB to gray. Alright, we can median filter the image using medFiltTo function, and let's make it a 7x7 median filter, and the result will look like this. So at this scale the result is not that visible, so let's make it a larger filter, say 15x15, and now it will be more clear to you what the median filter is doing. One very useful application of median filter is to get rid of salt and pepper noise. So let's create a noisy image by adding some salt and pepper noise to our grayscale image. Salt and pepper. Now as you will see, there are many completely white pixels, but if you look closely, there are also many completely black pixels. So this noise happens when the sensors are not working properly and just giving complete zero or complete one from time to time due to whatever reason. And because it looks like salt and pepper, it is called a salt and pepper noise. So you cannot get rid of this by mean filtering, because when you take the mean of these values, these ones and zeros will shift your result, so they will spread around and not disappear. So instead we can do median filtering, because when we do median filtering, these ones or zeros will just be at the very beginning or at the very end of the series. So the filtering result will pick from more realistic numbers that we see in the image. And we can do this by median filtering our noisy image. And 7x7 should be enough for this without degrading the image. Hop, the noise is gone. You can learn about functions about filtering in MATLAB that are predefined inside the library in this website, or also in the documentation that you can get by simply putting doc as a command in your MATLAB window. When we define filtering for a pixel, as you have seen, we are defining it in terms of its neighbors, but not all the pixels in an image have all their neighbors. For example, if you are at the boundary or corner of the image, these pixels will not have all their neighbors defined. So we have to do something about that. And there are different solutions to this. You can assume that those are zero. You can just mirror the image, or you can just repeat the last pixels over and over again. And you can set these in MATLAB as well. Our textbook also talks about this a bit more in detail. Check it out. Next, we will talk about image morphology. And here we will mainly talk about black and white images. This is not grayscale, but only 0 or 1. You will use these type of binary maps that are image sized when you are doing tasks like selecting a region or segmenting a region, or trying to detect something particular in the image. These will be your maps that shows you where you should be looking at. And there are some useful operations that we can do on them to get rid of some noise or to add some characteristics that we want. Let's see what I mean in MATLAB. To do morphology operations in the image, we first need to create a black and white image. And black and white images, or binary images, or logical images, can be used to define different regions in the image that we can select. So first, I will create an LAB image using RGB2 LAB of our image here. You can see that the first channel of the LAB color space, you can see that the first channel of the LAB color space will give you 100 times the brightness of the image, or the grayscale version of the image. This is how the L channel is defined in LAB color space. And we can also look at one of the color channels. Let's look at B. So this doesn't show us the actual B channel because the values do not vary between 0 and 1, but they take much larger or negative values, so we cannot see everything. But we can still use the MATLAB figure to figure out how we should do a segmentation on this one. So we see that most of the values we see around this t-shirt is either in the negative high 20s or in negative 30s. So we can check if we can do a segmentation using the color values of the t-shirt. And I will get my B channel and look for values smaller than, let's say, minus 25. So this gives us a binary image. So let's create a variable for this. Which will be a logical image of the same size, because this does per pixel comparison operation when you use large matrices with a single number. You can also compare matrices with matrices if they're of the same size. And we can now do some morphology operations on it and see what they mean. For example, let's erode our map. With a, I don't know, 5x5 kernel. As you see, the erode function eroded the binary map, or it shaved away some values or some ones around the white part of the map. We call it erode because it essentially makes the map a little bit smaller by looking at the neighborhood inside this little kernel that we give it. And it marks it a zero if there is any zero value inside this neighborhood that we provide for this filtering operation. There is the negative of this operation called dilation, which will do exactly the opposite. When there is a single one value inside this neighborhood, then it will just produce a one value in the middle as well, which in the end makes the map a little bit larger. So this is very useful if you are getting segmentation results that needs to be a bit larger. And you can do first erode and dilation, or first dilation and then erosion, to create more morphological operations. One of them is called imOpen, and the other one is called imClose. This one is called close because it is able to fill in or close down the holes inside an image depending on how large the kernel is. And the other one is called open because it makes the outer edges of the map a little bit smoother. The reading assignments for this lecture are sections 3.2 and 3.3. And as further reading, you can check the Wikipedia page on bilateral filtering or convolution. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in our edge detection lecture.